think just that for all sentient beings throughout space, to be think that you must bring them all to the state of lasting happiness of Buddhahood, and for that reason that you will practice the practice the Dharma of the Mahayana, in order to, and so please listen with this motivation of bodhicitta. And the Dharma that we are listening to is the advice given by Tilopati Naropa on the banks of the Ganges River called the Ganges Mahamudra. Now, among this, there are In the Indian language, Mahamudra Badeshan, the English language, the fifth instruction called the language of Mahamudra, I prostrate to the Vagos Vajra Dakini. And so that's first the introductory material of mentioning the name of the text and prostrating to the Vajra Dakini. Speaks about the meaning of this fifth instruction, talking about the nature of the ground path and fruition and so this is the union of means and emptiness, prostrating to this which pervades all of the ground path and fruition. Then following this is the pledge to give the pith instructions. This is the commitment or the pledge to give these. And it reads, intelligent Naropa who endures hardship, respects the guru and bears suffering, you are fortunate to take this to heart. So when you talk about endures hardship, I spoke about this earlier, and I also spoke about respecting the guru. And so as I explained before, when we were teaching the profound and vast understanding, is that you can talk about everything that you understand, and teaching it to everyone who wants to listen to it, and teaching to everyone who wants to listen. It shouldn't be like that. Instead, in order, when teaching the profound nature, the guru and the disciples, the teacher and the listeners, between the two of them, there have to be a profound connection. And without wasting the blessings of the lineage, it needs to be beneficial. So it shouldn't just benefit you, but so to be able to, if you're able to practice this from lifetime after lifetime, and the best that you can achieve Buddhahood in a single lifetime, and so this is the sequence should be done so that they can be able to put all these pith instructions together and combine them so they practice them, so that because of the compassion of the guru and the student's devotion, there is a profound connection. This happens because of the Dharma. And generally, when we are speaking about the Mahayana Dharma, this is necessary. And in particular, when we're talking about teaching these profound instructions such as these, we need to have a profound connection of knowing the reasons for it. If it's merely that the guru is speaking as much as he can, telling as much as he can, and the student, like going shopping in a store, picking what they want, it is not at all like that. And sort of in order to understand that, we need to realize the greatness of the guru and the greatness of the disciple. Now, the greatness of the guru is not like someone or a mere someone. It's like the great master of the past who have achieved the realization when they practice the Dharma. Because they practice, they manifested the result. And we have this level of realization where you know it's going to be practical benefit, where it's going to be practical help and benefit. And so under that way, they need to benefit the sentient beings. It's not something that is just taught as a great Dharma. And then the person that in terms of teaching too, it shouldn't just be merely intelligent, it shouldn't be just someone who has discernment. It shouldn't just be merely someone who has interest in the Dharma. But it has to be someone who has had a profound connection with this Dharma for many lifetimes, who has the profound imprints of this in this, someone who has been able to. Somebody who is, you know, who thinks day and night whether it would be wrong if I could practice this, couldn't I practice this? So they have goosebumps and tears in their eyes. So this is someone who's like, so this is actually and so teaching these characters to the students is incredibly important. It's even more than the main, more than the actual practice of it. So usually, if it's someone who just has an understanding, they would just say what they can. And the person that we're teaching to is it's someone who has actually the qualifications. And so if we don't think about whether there's a connection, an authentic connection, and the student thinks, oh, I need to listen to the teaching of the Mahamudra, so please tell me, of course, I'm going to listen to it. But if you're not thinking, I'm going to think that these are the characteristics that are necessary at the very beginning, middle, and end. They don't think about this. They don't have any interest in that. And so when we teach them, when we just teach it and just listen to it, then it's very difficult for blessings to enter your beings. And it's that's a situation that we're in. As it says in the Four Sitting Guru, it says, remembering from my heart that death is certain. Devotion in the Guru and renunciation from the best of my heart, may I receive the blessings and make a gaja. As it says here, and if we want to play to the Guru, the Karmapa, the Mikyo Dorje, then it's saying Karmapa Chena doesn't just bring this devotion. We need to have the unmistaken basis and the unmistaken path of this, as it has been. So from beginning, we have to remember death from our heart that death is certain. We have to remember from our hearts that death is coming. We need to have the thought of impermanence. When we say practice dharma it should be something that is going to take more than months and years, and not just something just for a few times. Something that is going to remembering that there's death from the Dharma, and remember the impermanent nature of this life, and incorporating that thought into our beings, and then be able to practice that impermanence. And we develop the weariness and renunciation that comes from the understanding of impermanence. Then we have the condition we need to. So it's remembering that death is certain. When you say certain, death is certainly going to come. When it will come, we do not know. It is, we don't even know when it could happen. It's not certain that it won't happen now. It's not something we don't know. This is a thought that we have to have a very short focus. We have to focus on what is immediate. And with that, sort of, we need to develop the certainty in the Dharma. And instead, if we have this idea that life is going to be permanent, think of the next, tomorrow, the next year, the next month, next year. And if we always put it off like that, then we'll overcome by laziness, we're overcome by discouragement and so forth, and we will not be able to make it into a practical benefit. And so in order to have it as a practical benefit, we have to have the thought that is of our life being impermanent. And we realize it is impermanent, then on that basis we can develop devotion. And when we have, and so when we have the practice Mahamudra, we have to have the understanding that the revulsion, that the ultimate revulsion, if we realize the thing we need to go from moment to moment, if we practice in this way, then it's definite that we will be able to receive the blessing of the Dharma that is not to. And so this sort of it's remembering from the heart that this is certain. We have to remember from the heart. It's not just from our mouth. We can say with our mouth that it's a changing, that it's not permanent or stable. And we can't just say that. We always recite the Four Session Guru Yoga. In the Four Session Guru Yoga practice, and because the blessings of the Guru have to come through the Four Session Guru Yoga practice, whether we receive the blessings and the conditions have to be present within for us. And so first we remember that, remembering from our hearts that death is certain, we must have that thought. This is not just a question of Guru Yoga. We must, even from the moment we begin practicing the Dharma, we must have that thought that everything is impermanent. But usually we don't think about it with this. We think, oh, I'll do it tomorrow. I'll do it the next day. It's okay. I can take my time. I still got time. Right now I'm healthy. I've got no particular deficits. I'm not going to die now. And when we are overcome by this laziness and this procrastination, then there's no witness. We're going to be able to actually practice. As the great masters of the Kadapa said, there's no certainty when Dharma will call them. And so we need to practice. Somewhere we need to practice from now on. And when we, at the time we die, nothing other than Dharma practice will help us. And so for that, we need to accomplish the Dharma now. And they would write the posters on their walls of the place where they stayed, saying, "Don't be distracted! Don't be distracted! Death will come." And so we all think about that. One day, we'll think, "Oh, this life is impermanent." But it's even doubtful that we'll have this idea even once that we don't know when death will happen. Definitely, there are two types of doubt: that tends to the shit, that tends to the later. And when you think, "Oh, I'm not going to die, am I?" That's probably tending towards the untruth. And so, thinking people really understand impermanence are very are rare. So, for that reason, remembering from our heart that death is certain. And so the Guru Yoga is the ultimate practice that we need. In order to do that, we need to have these characters, remembering from our heart that death is certain. Nagarjuna also said, by knowing raising, realize that we're perishing. By understanding perishing, realize that we are impermanence. By understanding that impermanence, we will be able to realize the deficit is. And so this is talking about, here we're talking about the profound meaning of emptiness. In order to reach that, first we need to understand that things arise, or the birth. But because we understand that things arise and understand the nature of arising, we understand that there's perishing. We need to understand that the nature of perishing, then we need to develop the understanding of impermanence in our being. And when we have that understanding of impermanence, then that'll aid us in realizing that the Dharma nature or the ultimate emptiness. And so we need to remember emptiness. The Bhagavan also said that the idea of impermanence is the greatest of all ideas. So when we first get up in the morning, think, I didn't die. So that's the Kadampa Dhamma says, today I didn't die. The fact that I still have this day to practice Dharma is because of the blessings of the Guru and the particular and my special deity. So I need me to do this. And so from today, from the beginning, I will have the actions, the intentions and the actions of from refuge and bodhicitta, and through my practice to this and do the practice. And then even when they go to the bed, and when I go to the dead, I thought, when you think, is it? There was no certainty that I wasn't going to die, and now when I go to sleep, there's no certainty that I'm going to wake up. And so they don't get, by thinking in this, they would not be over too attached to the ideas of being permanent and lasting. And so for that reason, thinking about impermanence is extremely important. And this is not something that I'm just saying. This is what is said right in the four things. This is what's said in the four session Guru Yoga. Remembering from our heart that death is certain. Then so what it says, with genuine devotion in our beings. And so it's a genuine devotion. So it said, this is respecting the Guru, as it said, we need devotion. And that devotion, it shouldn't just be merely oral, best of our mouths and words. It's when we believe in the qualities of the Guru. And even if all the Buddhas, the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas were combined in a single one, they wouldn't be even greater than just a single pore on the Guru's body. I mean, that's the sort of devotion we have to need. That sort of confidence we have. And this should be shown. This should be from now until we achieve enlightenment, not just months or years, but from the time until we achieve enlightenment. And once we have achieved Buddhahood, as it said, the Kadampa says, we need to be never to be separate from the Guru's body, the Guru's speech, and the Guru's mind. As for that, we need to have devotion in ourselves, and that devotion must be that never gets lax. It shouldn't be dependent on circumstances. In one circumstance we have conditions, we have devotion. In another condition, we don't have it. That's not the devotion we have. So from now until we achieve enlightenment, without being thinking about whether the Guru is pleased or displeased or anything, but I'm pleased with it. Even though the Buddhas are all equal in the qualities, this Guru is superior for me in terms of his kindness. And so this is Vinicius. And so then devotion is extremely impermanent, especially for us Kagyus. We say that it's a transmission of devotion. We say all the time that the Kagyu is the tradition of devotion, but when we talk about this as a transmission of devotion, but we go out and we receive empowerments from the Gurus, and then we go out and we criticize the Lama. And so we go and we go inside and we are ready to receive the vase and all the different empowerments, and we go out and we sell other things. And so that's how we ask for empowerments, and there's nothing going to happen out of that. During the secret mantra of under practice, we need to actually visualize the Guru as the Vajra Master, the empowerment for that. Then at that point, only then can we become the Vajra Master and the Vajra student. Before that, before we develop the wisdom of the basic nature within us through the empowerment, we don't become Vajra Master and Vajra student. And so. So we need to receive the empowerments. And in order to receive the blessing that we see from that, And so until we achieve, those blessings need to stay in our beings until we achieve an enlightenment as the deity of that, as a member of that mandala and so forth. And so when we go through that, then through the creation stage and the completion phase, we'll be able to achieve the result and we'll be able to achieve the state of Buddha. Now, of course, there are different explanations of this in the different tantras, but this is the general way to go. And when you go through the practice in this way, then the root of this is devotion. And when because of the devotion, then all of the appears and exists being the display of the Guru happens because of this. And so this, we talk. So when we recite words about prayers about this, we don't have devotion. Is it very difficult? So there's no. If we don't have that real devotion, then it's difficult for everything to that appears and exists to appear as the display of the Guru. So from the very beginning, we have the refuge and the go to devotion. Then we need to develop the genuine devotion in our being. Then so that then we can be. Then all that appears and exists appears as the display of the Guru. And when they display the display of the Guru, then at that point we make progress after that. We can realize that all the blessings of all the three roots we can get from the single Guru. The Buddha is the Guru. The Gurudham deity is the Guru. The Dakini and the Pradhamapatakras are all present within the single. Within a single Guru Yoga, everything is complete. And when we realize that, then the devotion includes, then the result of the practice comes from that union of our devotion and prajna. And so that's when we have that genuine devotion that is unaltered, unfabricated devotion. And so we need to also have the basis of the ultimate wish for emancipation. Once we have that, then we can receive the blessings. We receive the blessings of the Eighth Karmapa Mikyagawa, or the Mikyo Dorje. And so this is one of the, this is saying Mikyagawa. This is a name of Mikyo Dorje, but Karmapa's name, but it is a complete name, it's anyone. So we're talking about respect for the Guru, so devotion is extremely important. Now, when we talk about respect, it means like paying respect, and we bow when the Guru comes, we stick out our tongues, we stick it out very far. And then we touch the head of this, and then we talk about the rest. Then we talk about this being respecting the Guru. When we see the Guru as a kilometer, they stick out our tongues, and that's like respect, isn't it? But that's not it. That's not okay, for example. There is physical, there's verbal, and what we really need is the mental respect. That's what we said. The sutras talk about paying respect to their body with prostrations and so forth, in court and so forth. But here, devotion is something that has to come within our men. We talk about devotion, we said yearning and dedication. And it's thinking, what would be wrong if I developed all of the blessings of the Guru? That is the yearning. That's the yearning. Developing the qualities of the Guru's mind, the special qualities of the Guru's mind. Just hearing the names of the Gurus, if we just be able to receive the qualities of the blessings of the. And so those are the Guru has these qualities, and those are just, and we need to exaggerate the Guru with our own intelligence. We see that this is enough. We see that there is nothing in us, and we realize that there is nothing more. Then we have yearning for it, and because of that yearning, and then in order to develop the qualities of the Guru within us, we need to have the continual and the enthusiastic devotion. We need to continually practice, continually train, continually drum. We need to continually incorporate it into our being, and that is dedication. And when that happens, we talk about devotion, or we need to receive the instructions from the Guru, listen to it one-pointedly. Then we develop a contemplation, develop meditation, and then we practice this one-pointedly, then the stains of the imprints of ignorance in our being become even thinner and thinner. Become even thinner. I think if we become even more profound, it's not profound, it's like become more thin, and so become thinner, they're smaller and smaller. And the faith, devotion, and world awareness and stuff get longer, get larger and larger, and bodhicitta grows like the moon, and all the faults are like the waning moon, so they go less and less. And then when we have that, when we develop that realization, those qualities in our being, and we say, this happened because of the Guru, because I received the pith instructions from them and practiced them. I developed these incredible qualities, and then you have this excitement here, but this yearning, and when that yearning is, then the devotion naturally occurs. That guru is really something the embodiment of all the gurus, of all the Buddhas coming to one. He is the infinite activity of all the Buddhas. And there's nothing better. This is just enough. You are the guru, you are the yidam, you are the dharmakaya, you're the dakini, you're the karma practice, you are the embodiment of all the jewels. The embodiment of all the jewels, of all the roots and so forth. I don't need anything else, anyone else. And that certainty, that devotion, that confidence develops at that time. So at the beginning, we have to practice the oral instructions. And if we don't practice the oral instructions, then the Buddha may be popular and well-known and may travel all over in the world and have many worlds, and that doesn't help. He may have many students out there, and a great benefit depends. It doesn't benefit. Benefiting beings, at this point, what we don't benefit comes into teaching the Dharma, realizing the points of this, and think about these matters, and be able to, as a practice this, and teaching the results of one's own practice of view, meditation, and conduct, teaching that to others and being practical benefit to others is benefiting. Benefiting a single benefit is a benefiting being, and benefiting two or three is a benefit. It doesn't fit. Three or four or five is still benefited. It doesn't mean that it's going to be benefiting a lot of people amidst a lot of lies. Benefiting that sort of benefit is can become mistaken or perverted. Not knowing how, and because we don't know about how to take care of all the students, and then thinking about gain and profit and gathering a large retinue of students and so forth. And if that's how it is, then the Dharma isn't becoming the Dharma. The difference of the peerless Dukwan talked about there's a difference between Dharma become not functioning as Dharma, and it says taught and so the. As taught in the precious garland, the sublime path. And so you need to follow the stage of the practice from refuge on, and for that, and that is the devotion, in brief. So intelligent Narupa Hundur's homage, the respects the guru, so respecting the guru is the second. And the third is bears suffering. You need to be able to be a forbear suffering. When you're talking about suffering, is a bear with it? That doesn't mean, that's not what we're talking about here. It isn't saying you should bear with it when your foot hurts, or with your eyes hurting when you see things. As in the story of Milarepa's liberation, no matter what cold, heat, or heat, or suffering, or hunger, or thirst, he didn't think about any of those, and he practiced without disregarding those entirely with his entire body, speech, and mind, not letting himself be distracted. I'm not going to let them go towards mistaken thoughts. I'm going to make sure that all my going, sitting, walking, sitting, and that they don't become mistaken. With my body, speech, and mind, virtue, these are not dependent upon anything else. While I'm sitting, while I'm going. And at that time, I'm trying to make everything go become the path to enlightenment. And that is what we mean by this being able to bear suffering. So being able to bear suffering. In Milarepa's song, so practicing with fortitude is service to the guru. Practicing with the fortitude, so the fortitude means having fortitude in practicing the Dharma, not thinking about anything about enduring suffering. No matter how many hardships you have to go, accepting them, that is fortitude. The second characteristic is being able to bear with lacking everything, and when you have any adversity and difficulties, but you should not be affected by those conditions, and you should not be stopped. You should be able to face up to those suffering, face up to the difficulties, because of the root of the ignorance of ego clinging, we have all the samsara. Like, I need this, I need that, I need all of the good facilities, I need all of the benefit for myself, I need all the victory to go to me. And when that goes wrong, then we have all the physical difficulties. In our mind, we have the And so, and then there are many different harmonies that we think that there are ghosts, there are monsters and stuff. And we often talk about ghosts. We said that there's a ghost and that there's a ghost in it. And so we need to get a guru who can exercise the spirits and that, and someone who is someone who has dreadlocks in the top of his head, someone who is able to do this, someone who's vidit, someone who is able to do all the exorcism rituals and able, and he's carrying their kila, but and whatever the iron purba stuff, and thinking that's going to benefit, and we do think. And we think, and we don't think about our dharma practice as something that can be, as something that is going to reduce our ego thing. We think about it as something that is going to actually increase. We bring in that mara that comes in, and when you think that mara is ourselves, and we have to, and when it comes in, the lama comes to the guru, and so and you say that there are the ghosts of the living and the ghosts of the dead, and so when you say that, we say that it's not me, but it's actually something that we've made up with our own mind. It's something we say that is. A living ghost or a dead ghost. And when the guru, when the lama gets in your head, he said, if someone has a characteristic, and he said, there's no goddess in it, it's because of your mind being confused. You are seeing it as a ghost, but actually there is none. But when you say that it's, but if you say that the ghost is your own mind, then that would be beneficial. But instead, oh yeah, there is. There's that living ghost is yours. So there's something bigger, isn't it? There's one even bigger than you think, and I'm going to be able to I'm going to tell it, to subdue it, and that person who can see it is me. So bring me the beef. I'm going to do this now. And so, but when you think of it, that actually the person who makes it up is you. There's a person who's thinking there's the ghost. That's the sponsored it. There's the ghost as well. The person who subdues it also great, and so in that way there are it's a bit where it's like we have a big encampment an encampment of ghosts, like we'd have a military encampment, and we're having a ghostly encampment, and there's no benefit to that, is there, from the beginning of some sort to know, because of this idea that there is a self. We have the suffering. It is not made by the ghost, it's not by the nagas, it's not made by the practice, it is not made by anything outside of what are the ghosts made? It's made by our mistaken mind that clings to itself. That means and so the inside we have this. So what need do I have this monster, as it says in the way of the Bodhisattva? Then if we are able to tame that, then because all of the external things that appear as monsters on the outside are actually, they do not naturally exist. They will naturally be subdued when you realize that get rid of the monster in your own mind. So we grasp what is not a self as a self. We grasp what is not true as being as true. And because of that mistaken mind, then we think that I was getting hot, I'm getting sick. And then we add that all on top of it. We add it on top of the ego clanging. And then in order to tame that, we need to apply all of the antidotes of the practice to that ego clinging, and devote our entire Dhamma practice to that. We have experienced continual suffering, experienced many different sufferings, and they're not made by ghosts or spirits. They're made by our erroneous clinging to a self. And so that monster is actually clinging to itself, and in order to tame it, we need to undergo the hardship of practicing the Dharma. We need to undergo the hardship of asking for a guru, of requesting the teachings, and then when we do the practice, and then we do incorporate it into our being, so that the Dharma and the being are not separate. It's that when they actually become. We need to undergo the hardships to do that. When we make our Dharma practice, bring it to the point, then all of the suffering and the there, even if there are many difficulties of heat and cold and hunger and thirst and so forth, we must not do that. But we must not be put because of it, the sufferings that occur because of ego clings, such as the suffering of the lower realms, are pointless. So we have no choice but to suffer. That's it. And there's a suffering of that doesn't benefit Benedict. It cannot purify all of our misdeeds. It cannot purify wrongdoings or misdeeds. But if we have fortitude, and if we endure hardship from practicing the Dharma, then that has a meaning. It has a point. We need to be able to endure the suffering, and be able to see and face up to it and accept that suffering. Then that can have great benefit of purifying our misdeeds and gathering the accumulations. And so that is meaningful suffering. And so it says, bears suffering. It's what we said is we suffering. So we have the Ningru, the suffering of the. So we need to have the fortitude and the. And so from the time we begin until we achieve realist independence, until we achieve suffering, we need to accept all of the sufferings of heat, cold, hunger, and thirst, and practice the Dharma. And by doing this, we can able to the qualities of being able to achieve liberation in a single lifetime come from that. But we are unable to do these hardships. We are not able to forget about enduring suffering. We're not able to really serve our spiritual masters, our gurus. And it's very difficult to forget about it in this time. There's no one who even knows how to serve their guru or as a master. And say, people will say that we go to the guru and say, oh, the guru, please, I need some, there's a guru, please expel the guru, put the vajra on my head and raise up to somebody wanted me. We think about the guru as like an exorcist, and then the guru plays along with that, and for that reason. Because of that, developing refuge in bodhicitta, developing bodhicitta, developing that being the idea of bodhisattva, developing faith, devotion, bodhicitta, developing the samadhi of practice, not devotion, because that's what the connection between guru and disciple has become like. And so before we actually do practice Mahamudra practice, we have to have all the right conditions to do it. If we don't have the right conditions, then the previous gurus all underwent it, all said that we endure the suffering, respect the guru and by suffering, we're not able to do it. If we aren't able to incorporate that into our being, then it's just leaving on words on paper doesn't benefit. It's like Milarepa. We have to be like Milarepa, and actually, as he said, being able to put through, being able to undo the suffering is serving the guru. Staying alone in the mountain retreat is a service to the guru. Staying in the isolated places. Alone, the reason why I had to stay alone in the mountains was in order to decrease his greed and devotion, is to decrease his ego clinging, decrease his clinging to truth. And the reason for that is because what prevents us practicing the Dharma is the ego clinging. It's clinging to truth. It's the wrong to that. It's the unworkable mind. And because of this, we have obstacles in practicing the Dharma. And you know the reason what. And if we have difficulties developing refuge within our being, why is that? What prevents us from realizing impermanence is clinging to things as being true. What prevents us from developing bodhicitta is our clinging to things as true. So we have to play to, as we say, please grant me to give up thoughts of inquinum. Please grant me to realize that everything is futile. Ramli raise me to everything that to stop non-dharmic thoughts. Please must to realize that my mind is on board. Bless me that isn't it. Bless me to realize that confusion. To dispel confusion and so forth. And we say, please bless him. It means not that we have to get something from us, but we need to practice it. We have to do it. We have to practice Dharma. We have to have fortitude. And we have to do that. And if we practice it in this way, then we will receive the blessings in our minds. And once we do, then just as we have prayed, we will be able to accomplish the what we have prayed for. And so then our practice can actually become real practice. It's an important guru, as a guru different from others. I'm just saying this. What is the difference between guru and others? Is more handsome, is very tall, is very, isn't it? Because he's tall and unlike other others. It's because he or she's fat and stuff like that, so it has a lot of blessing. The guru has another blessing because the guru has no blessings because they're thin. And because we don't say that because they're thin that they have no blessings. The guru is rich. There's a big monastery. And there's a big and there's a golden roof, and the pillars are all gold and silver. Then that doesn't make sense. What makes an important guru is it's not a question of their title or their the height of their throne. It doesn't have to do anything. It doesn't mean it. it's not a question of what is the name. What makes the importance of the guru, what's mega important in some ways, is that it's because when we serve a guru like that, and we receive the present instructions practically, and we practice those properly, and if we develop a result from our practice, then for that individual, that guru is important. And that sort of a guru, when you take the received visit, then we'll be able to receive that. And in order to be able to achieve that level of quality of the gurus, we have to have a lot of fortitude to do this. We need to spend the times it is. So the practicing the fortitude is serving the guru. So think about the driving joy of and happiness about Patanjali. This is like a sweep that can rip away all of our suffering. It's like you know, when we talk about it as it's something that can be, it's a condition that can sweep away all our suffering. It's like a broom that can sweep it all away. So then we think, I'm sick, I've got pain, and we worry about that, I'm going to die. We worry I'm going to die, and we have the expectation I'm going to die, or the expectation. The expectation of someone is going to criticize, and we have all that in our mind, and then many different things. Sometimes it's like that the practitioners actually have more worries than other people. They have many more suspicions than other people. First of all, we have to develop renunciation from samsara. We say we develop that. We develop the wish for liberation from samsara. We say we go forth and we wear the monastic clothes. I've taken on the monastic robes. And we say that we enter the monastic community, and we say I've gone forth. And this is seeing that the samsara is seeing as false, seeing the defects of samsara. And because of that, then we go forth. And this is the way it goes. That's when you say, do you consent to having your hair cut? Then you say, I agree. And so because of that, we end up practicing. And we understand the cause and effects of samsara and the cause and effect of nirvana, and we understand this, and then we go to them and say, please give, and having that understanding, we go to the guru and we say, please give me the refuge vows, and the guru says, if you say, have you had a good, do you have a good understanding of the basis and of the four drills, it is, and give a do you have the good understanding of the Four Noble Truths to take this? It shouldn't be like where you're brought to the guru by your parents, and they say, do you consent to having your hair cut? And you say, yes, I consent, because you're afraid that your mother's going to slap you instead. But right now, it's sort of like I say, it's like a lot of people, like they go through, they have difficulty in their business and so forth, and then they're having difficulty, so they enter the sangha, and so that is not the appropriate way to go. This, but then you have to develop the wish for you should have take the refuge with the understanding from the depths of your heart that you need refuge from refuge of practice from the suffering of samsara. And so in this way, when we then begin in the practice in this sangha, then eventually we get to the end of we can arrive at the completion of our practice. And so the joy at sickness and joy at death is, and happiness at death is like the broom that can sweep away the misdeeds and sufferings. And so because of then all the difficulties, problems, all the erroneous obstacles, then we don't think about this, and we think that yet in fact that these are actually siddhas, that they're actually benefits to us. Whether praised or whether we're confused, whichever, then we don't have no attachment, and we just leave it indifferent. If it does, people don't care, there's no problem. If these points are permissible, I don't have to think. And so if they pointed out my faults, and someone's criticizing me and trying to bring me down, and so may this become a condition for me to become, may that person become a condition for them to achieve enlightenment. If someone praises them, may that become a condition for them. And it's like this is. It's like the Madhusudan. We need to stop our hopes and fears as the Kanapa Master said. And whatever circumstances, we need to face up to it. Sufi Guru said, this is what it means in breathing. So let's talk about bare sufi. It's like as Milarepa said, this fortitude of joy at sickness and happiness with death is the broom that sweeps away misdeeds and obscuration. So this means that it says bare suffering. And the last one is intelligent Naropa. In English, it comes first. When you say intelligent number, it means someone who is intelligent, someone who is smart, who has developed progeny with their being, and someone that, and by properly examining and investigating the nature of things are, that is where the intelligence comes in. If we do not have that proper progeny, that proper intelligence, then we will be deluded about what we should do and what we should not do. And we won't know, understand, and we will not properly know what we should have done. We may know the ways to give up, but if we do not have the if we lack that intelligence, we will not be able to practically give up. We should give up. What we do will not become the proper. So this is intelligent. First, intelligent, and in addition to that, have to be able to endure the suffering. And with having the intelligence, we need to have the respect and bear suffering. This is important, isn't it? Intelligent. Having the intelligence and discernment first is very important. If you don't have that intelligence first, then no matter what dharma you practice, it will not become proper, or will not work properly. So the basis for all qualities that we can see or see is prajna. Therefore, you must develop prajna. When you say all the qualities that are seen and unseen, when you say seen means those that we see in this lifetime. When you say those that are unseen, the unseen qualities of the future lifetimes. So the seen and unseen qualities, the seen qualities of this life and the unseen qualities of the future, and what do these depend upon? The root of them all is prajna. They depend upon prajna. And so we need to develop that true prajna within our beings. And if we develop, then we'll be able to manifest the seen and the unseen qualities. And so it's the root of all the other. And so those who want to, in order to develop these within our beings, we need to develop that prajna within our beings right now. So prajna is like intelligence, being able to understand what is good and what is bad. We enter the Buddhist teachings, and we practice this the stage of the path, and we need to examine it. Say, this is appropriate, this is inappropriate. It's like it's not just something that it's the Buddha gave a command, and this is a rule. It's something whether it's the Pratimoksha vows or the Bodhisattva vows or the Samaya, these are something we have to examine. We have to use our problem. This is the reason why I have to give up this. This is the reason why we need to practice this. And so we have to have the certainty that comes that is developed by our own intelligence, and the belief that is developed from our intelligence, the faith that comes from our intelligence, and then only then can we practice the training in discipline and samadhi, and then only then will that become the cause for us to achieve liberation and omniscience. And then it will become the antidote to everything that needs to be limited. And so this is why Nagarjuna has said this was necessary. So intelligent respect the guru and bear suffering. You who are fortunate, take this to heart. So take this to heart. So this is Nora. So those qualities that you have, with the intelligence of discernment, but because of through the qualities of being able to endure suffering, having excitement about that, and respect for the guru, and a willingness to bear the suffering, these qualities that come from the intelligence, you have those. The one who has this is Naropa. And for that reason, so take this to heart, and so think in this way. Think in this way. Make your mind like this. And so the intelligence is really important. So this last quality of intelligence is that you have to be just merely being intelligent. Somebody said here, the son take this to heart, the mind here, this particular mantra. So that particular mantra, what we need for that is really, what we have to have for heart here is like a really intelligent mind. Invested mind that comes from this. We need to have the intelligence that can actually see in the nature of nature as it is. Without that, then enduring hardship, respecting the guru, and professing that it's just giving yourself a hard time. It's just like tradition. It's like these are things that they say you have to do. We talk about like that, and there's not the banishment of it. It's like we're bound by our thoughts if you don't have the intelligence. Without intelligence, we're bound by our thoughts. And once we're bound by our thoughts, then what we're bound to, we aren't able to get out of it. It's like we're in a prison. If you're in a prince, you can't. If you're bound by chains, you cannot free yourself from them. So in this jail of suffering, we are bound here. We are bound by our thoughts. Particularly in Buddhism, we're talking about the Dharma, the self-liberation of the Dharma, the self-revision of thoughts. So what is important is self-discipline. Self-liberation of desire, self-liberation of hatred, self-liberation of delusion, self-liberation of enviousness, and so forth. And so if we have this, we don't need another antidote. We know the nature of the world. We know the way it is. We know the way that it manner. We know that it's character. We know that it's a basis. And when we know that, then we don't need to apply an external antidote. Self-arising, self-liberating. And so that is what we're talking about. And so that is the heart, the mind that we're talking about here. So we need to develop that sort of intelligence. If we aren't able to do that, we won't be able to develop all of the qualities that are talked about. As it says in the way, entering the middle way. So ordinary beings are submitted. So when you talk about the result, there's a result of intelligence. What is liberating ourselves from the bind of thoughts, and that is developing non-thought. That is what it is. And so releasing the binds of thought and developing non-thought. That is one, isn't it? So ordinary beings are bound by thoughts. Yogis are freed to non-thought. And so when we stop the thoughts, then we develop the non-thought, the thought-free wisdom that we develop. That is a result of our intelligence. And so for that reason, we talk about intelligent ears. And the intelligent ears is not just intelligence. It's not just prajna. It is the knowing the way the mind is, the nature, the essence of the mind. And one element is not... If we don't see them as false and think that this is something I need to get rid of, the moment the thought that the mind appears, then we realize that it's self-arising, self-liberated. If we get to that point, then that is the type of intelligent talking we hear. You are fortunate to take this to heart, and so we're able to think in this way. And so that completes the pledge to give the instructions on Mahamudra. The next is the... The next stanza presents the nature of Mahamudra. The nature of the Buddha, it gives the actual presentation of the nature of Mahamudra. Mahamudra cannot be shown. Just as who can show space to whom? Just as who can show space to whom? Likewise, there's nothing to show in the nature of Mahamudra. So this one, we're pointing out the nature of the nature of Mahamudra. Mahamudra cannot be shown. Mahamudra cannot be shown when we say that. To make it understood, there's no way you can show Mahamudra. Because Mahamudra transcends words. It's ineffable, it's inconceivable. There's no thing you can think about. There's no object of thought, nothing you can show, no one who can show it. And so Mahamudra cannot be shown. As I said before, as I said, I, Taylor, have nothing to show. If you see your own essence, then you are, I have nothing to show. There's an object you put over there. And there's something that you put up that you showed with words and words and symbols to show this is Mahamudra. There's no way to show it. It cannot be illustrated by any convention that we talk about Prajnaparamita. It is not. It cannot be an object of conceptualization. It cannot be an object of dualism because it has transcended those. It is all words and thought. It involves all apprehending thoughts, and for that reason, they cannot realize the Prajnaparamita. And so similarly, Mahamudra cannot be shown. As it cannot be shown, it's like, doesn't mean that there's something to be shown that can't be shown. It's the nature of Mahamudra itself. Transcends any words, thoughts, or any characteristics, or so forth. Just as who can show space to whom? The mind cannot be shown. It can be described. In the space, It cannot be signified by any different terms or means. And similarly, there's nothing to show in the nature of Mahamudra. And this way, there's nothing to show. So how do you need to practice that? And so how do you practice this? Within your own nature, and not changing, resting in equipoise, you will be able to see the nature. Saraha said, we may say space, but the essence of space cannot be said. We say space all the time, but when you talk about space, it's just a word. There's a projection, but there's actually nothing that we can show with it. We say space, but the nature of space cannot be established as anything. When we say as anything, the space, the character, the characteristics of space, the nature, the color, the shape of space, and so forth. Whatever common characteristics you talk about, it cannot be shown. So similarly, just as who can show space, but whom? This is the same as saying the nature of space cannot be established as anything. So we say space all the time, but the nature of mind, isn't it? It's not something, not nothing, not both, not nothing. We can say it's not something. No, if we talk about any different thing, we say it's there. We say it's something, but it exists, and we say not, that's the opposite. It's not existing. So these two, so we have existing and not existing, and then opposite of that, we have the and not something and not nothing. It's not existing, not nothing, not something, not nothing, not other, not anything else. It's not existence as the nature, as an existing nature, not as a non-existent nature. It is not both of these. It's not neither of these. And so it's not both. It's not existent, not non-existent. It's not some other object that can be transcended. It is unable to be illustrated or shown. And so it is pure, the nature of the mind that is pure from the very beginning is the nature of Mahamudra, and that Mahamudra, and no matter how many you explain it with words and explanations, and how much you point it out, the nature transcends words and thoughts, and it transcends any description, so it cannot be shown by this world. Likewise, there's nothing to show in the nature of Mahamudra. If we think about it as Prajnaparamita, we talk about Prajnaparamita. When you think about the profound meaning of Prajnaparamita, it needs to transcend all thing and non thought of not thing and non thing. And as it talked in Bhagavad, when we say there's nothing at all, so when we say that there is a thing, when things or nothing, or being or non-being, and it transcends all of the experiences, so that is the we need to rest within the nature that is unobservable. That is Prajnaparamita. If there's no thing, then there's no then there's nothing. If there's no, because nothing depends on there being something. Nothing that is also dependent upon things. So thing and nothing both depend upon each other. If there's no thing, then there can be nothing. If there's no nothing, there can be things. Then there can be no thing. So both, so does not that. So does the view that transcends all of the things or nothing. It's the nature that is beyond all extremes is Prajnaparamita, is Mahamudra, middle way. There are many different names, but what they point to is the same thing. There's nothing else than those. And talk about Buddhas, the nature. All the qualities within ourselves manifest that as Buddhas. If we have if we go to the ultimate of our practice and so forth, then we achieve the result. It's just but it's just that nature that is there. It's not something you can talk about this. There is, as it says in this, there is in the Sublime Kivina, there is no Buddhahood other than suchness. So there is no Nirvana. There is nothing. It says said here, there is nothing to Mahamudra can be shown. There is nothing to shown to us. Likewise, nothing to show in experience. So if there is nothing, doesn't have to do with it. We need to experience. We need to rest in the nature, resting in the way we are, and cutting through our projections from the beginning. From the inside, that's what it is. It's not looking at external, we don't need to look at all the external things, directing our attention out at all these external things to look and find what the nature is. We need to look inside. By looking at our nature, we need to cut through our projections in our own mind. We need to develop from within ourselves. We develop conviction within ourselves. We need to cut through the projections inside ourselves. But of course, in order to do that, we need to have the scriptures and the literature. We need to take the words of the Buddhas and of the great Indian masters. And then, in addition, we need to have the proper logic, and then we put these two together in practice. Some people say that we don't need to have scripture and realization in order to practice Mahamudra. They say we don't need them, but that is the sign that they don't know. They're not talking that they don't know the text. But it's necessary. It says, and we need to have the path of that is in order to cut through the all projections. We need to have that. But we need to use the scripture and realization as a method to do this. We need to do. They're like our adornments, our embellishments to achieve. Otherwise, if you're a follower of Milarepa, then you say this is what Milarepa said. So if you said Milarepa didn't think you needed a scripture and realization, then you are not a follower of Milarepa. So then, what do we do for meditation? So the Milarepa just said about this: when thoughts develop, the merely doing practice, we need to develop experience, and we need to develop experience. And so I have the experience of meditation. I have that thought. To do meditation is like sleeping. And there's no benefit otherwise if there's no experience, and for that reason. So when the thoughts dissolve into the Dharmakaya, that is, so the Milarepa is going to say that. So the Milarepa said that for the thoughts, then the thoughts that need to dissolve into the Dharmakaya, and if that is the self, that is the uncontrived meditation. And so this is the self-arising, the unfabricated motivation. When the thoughts dissolve into the Dharmakaya, that means like this. The Dharmakaya is here and the thoughts are here, and it's like they're jumping like a jumping in the water and jumping in and just throwing the thoughts into the water of the Dharmakaya. It's not like that. Although if you say that, it'd be very funny and very difficult to say it. It's not like that. It's like liberating the thoughts as the Dharmakaya, knowing the nature. When we examine its nature and we cut through the root of them, then the thoughts dissolve into them. Because where they arise is they arise out of the Dharmakaya. They don't arise. There is not some separate thought, autonomous thought that does not come out of it. They're like the waves. Thoughts are like the waves in the ocean. And because of the cause of the waves appear because of that on the ocean because of the wind, but in the essence they are the ocean. So when we talk about the thoughts dissolve into the, it's not like throwing a water into the, it means like the thoughts being liberated as the Dharmakaya. So thoughts dissolving into the Dharmakaya. In order for the thoughts to isn't that called the self? When the thoughts dissolve into the Dharmakaya, is that called the uncontrived meditation? So what is the content of this? So it has to be. So you have to. The view has to be combined with the conduct has to with these. The six collections of consciousness, the external form, sound, smell, taste, and so forth. And then there are the six faculties, and there are the faculties, and you have these six. When these six consciousnesses and engage the external objects, then at that point we have the. attachment to the attractive forms and an aversion of the unattractive, because of the, and we're changed by the conditions of this, then we are unable to purify the six meters. Is when the object, if the nature does not distinguish between good or bad or beautiful or unbeautiful, and we have the conduct of being the of one taste and the, I mean the view and the meditation that are one taste. When we come to one the practice one taste, then it is like the there is nothing that you need to stop. Then when a good thought that there's nothing that you need to produce. When a bad thought occurs, there's nothing that you need to block. When you're enjoying the object, then there's you'd. It's not that you'd take on the good things and get rid of the bad things. There's you'd, without making any distinction between the good, bad, fine, or ugly. Whatever thought happens, whatever situation occurs, you just look directly at the nature of it and look directly at the nature of it without stopping or producing anything. Then they're purified where they are. Not purified of the rest, it's when we solidify the six objects and we cling to them as being true. We bind to them, cling to them totally. We cling to them as being specific, not some things that exist by their own characteristics. And then we aren't be able to, then we're not allowed our six consciousnesses to be natural and accumulate karma and so forth. And so then we guess of things as being impermanent and harmless. So then we accumulate. Then we do the karma, the good and the bad karmas. And we should not follow our pleasures. We should not be try to push away this displeasing. We should not follow our thoughts. We should not follow our thoughts as being good. We shouldn't follow our thoughts of things being bad. So letting the six consciousness be loose, then this is the conduct of equal taste. Right now we're equal taste. We say this is tasty, this is not tasty. We have these two, right? This is sweet, this is sour. This is delicious, this is not delicious. And it's like that. This is the example. This is the not equal taste. When you have equal taste, when we have for yogis who have cut through all projections and have realized the equality of samsara and nirvana, they realize that this is the nature of this samsara and nirvana, then they would be able to have the conduct of equal taste. And they said that sometimes that there are some there's some people that sometimes they talk about lamas who would eat feces and and so this is because they had the conduct of equal taste. They had no thought of being good things or being pleasant and pleasant. And when you're unable to realize, purify these six consciousnesses in their own place, then it was. And so when we, when we were able to let the six consciousnesses relax entirely and to be able to be loose, then we were able to engage in the practice of and we don't engage in this. Excuse me here. The nature of things as the nature of this, and we think about the nature of the from the very beginning, there is no the good and bad and bad. There's no fine and bad. But because of the thought, of the dualistic thoughts, it's projected by the we say this is good, this is bad. And we divide things into dualistic things with the good and pleasures, and the good and bad. This is made up by projected by our thoughts. And so, as long as we have that, then because of that, we have the benefit of things that benefit our harmless, and that's just the way the world works. And when the thoughts of there being benefit and harm, then the results of pleasure and pain that would come from that do not occur to them. And so, this becomes the yoga conduct of this of a single taste. So this happened at the right. This has to be connected with the times at the right time. So the conduct has to be connected with time. So what is the result? So when our minds when our mind is liberated into the Dharma nature, when the mind has become has gone beyond, when we get to that point, when we achieve that point, we call that achieving Buddhahood in a single lifetime. Isn't that called the Buddhahood in a lifetime? This is embellished by the four kaya. So it's the Dharma kaya that is yes, an emptiness, the Dharma kaya, and so forth. It's like when we gather the two accumulations, we receive the two kayas, right? And so because of the accumulation of merit, we achieve the form kayas, and because of the accumulation of wisdom, we achieve the accumulation. We achieve the Dharma kaya. So we talk the form kaya is the result of practicing the accumulation of merit, and the accumulation of wisdom results in the Dharma kaya. And so when we understand this, then whatever the result of this, of the four kayas, through the four kayas, we're able to benefit all people. So these are connected to this. And the reason why we're saying this is in the nature of Mahamudra, there's nothing to be shown. So this is the result of this. We need to cut them through inside, but they have to need the liberation. So this is why it says Mahamudra cannot be shown, just as who can show space to whom. Likewise, there's nothing to show in the nature of Mahamudra. Then it talks about how to practice this. So the nature of Mahamudra, how can we practice this properly? So what is the way to practice? Relax and rest in the unaltered basic nature. If the bonds are loosed, there's no doubt you'll be freed. These are two lines. Relax and rest in the unaltered basic nature. Unaltered. Letting it be. Not changing. Fresh. Not changing in it. If you don't change in it, hoping that it'll become better or something, then the natural nature is the basic nature that means within this basic luminous nature of mind, if you have left it unaltered, not trying to make it better or stop this worse, and you relax and rest, and then you live. Now these are not particular. These are not particular instructions of mind. This is sort of a common instructions of mind. Some people, this is a particular. This is something that can be taught in common. It's not what is actually there are different instructions that are for the people with the higher faculties who have to do the preliminaries, and then it's in practice and those. But here these are common teachings. Relax and rest in the unaltered best. Relax and rest. Relax means don't stop anything, don't block or produce. You can if thoughts happen, then let them happen. The meditation is not to stop thoughts or to eliminate thoughts. It's not to overcome or destroy thoughts. That's not why we meditate. Thoughts are what it is. In order for the thoughts are to become aids in our meditation, so that they're liberated in the Dharmakaya, so they become a benefit to our meditation. That's why we meditate. Most people think that when we practice, we need to stop our thoughts. We need to block them, and we need to do this forcefully. We need to forcefully stop our thoughts, and we think that that is the Mahamudra meditation, but it is not. If you think it is, then you won't be able to do the Mahamudra practice. So what do we need at this point? Whatever thought appears, without changing them in any ways, without any stopping or blocking or pressing, if they occur, let them occur, and then within the nature of the tension, without changing, without blocking or encouraging them, it's like drawing designs in ripple, designs in water. You can draw designs in mind, but they won't stay. So thoughts occurring and thoughts resident. Now the thoughts that we have in our mind, we think about our business isn't going, but we're having family problems, or having all these common worldly problems, then all of them, we can talk about many different means, but there are many difficulties. If we don't understand what to do, that it becomes very difficult, isn't it? And when these difficult feelings are sourced, find some way to actually practice, if we can be able to relax in our mind when that happens, if we can feel then we can relax within all of the within that space. Then we can feel some comfortable space. And so it says, relax and rest in the unaltered blessedness. Do not stand to block or produce. Let thoughts occur if they occur. If a thought occurs, this is it. If it occurs, you don't need to particularly grasp it and saying this is a good thought and this is a bad. Whatever thoughts, whatever appears, and look nakedly at its essence. I, the Yogi Milarepa, see this, looking directly, looking nakedly, see the essence. I, the Yogi Milarepa, looking nakedly, it's Chattachitta. Oh, so looking, staring at the Chattachitta, looking clearly and vividly, brightly, looking directly. When I look right at the nature, but it's not saying look in the eyes. It doesn't mean to look. I'm just sort of showing expression. It's not the mind. When I said they're not staring at your mind, it's like the way you look. And so the people look like they're sitting there staring. It's probably they've been distracted. So I, the victim, looking directly at the nature, seeing the nature of the mind. So looking directly means not stopping or producing, is look at whatever happens arising, just look directly. Think of this good or bad or pleasant or unpleasant or with any hope or fear. Not any predicating them as being anything. So looking directly at them, and seeing the nature. If you look in this way, what benefit is there when we talk about this? You see the unelaborate nature of space. Everything's, so when you say that unelaborate, that's what elaborate means changing, making something that's not something into something. So that something that elaboration means something that's binding something. It's erroneous. What's grasping is something that isn't and as being something. And so the unelaborateness that is like space. So when you talk about the space, it transcends any thoughts. But if you look at it, because when you look at the sky, we look it up and it seems like it's blue. But the blue is not actually the sky; it's just a color. The sky itself is not something that can be looked at or see. When you look at this image, we use the words that have to say this. But this is just nature. This is generally saying, generally as a convention that we see this in a, but how do you see this space and what's the sense? If when you examine it, so examine the nature of how you see the space, and if you don't, then you do not see the space. And the reason that we said that, because the space itself is not established as something that can be seen or that can see or be seen. And for that reason, space is not visible. And for that, because that, when we say, I see the nature of the mind, I see the mind, I see the way beings are, I've seen the way all things are, I see the nature, the basis of all things, I've seen the unaltered nature, we say all of these different things. We say this quite often. When we say seeing Dharma, what does it mean? How do we see it? How did you see the nature of your mind? What is the manner that you saw it? What are the characteristics of the thing? What is the way that you see? What is the when you look at how it is, then there's actually nothing that you can see. Just say, merely, there's no other object that can actually elaborate things, so it's like this. Milarepa himself said that, Milarepa said, looking directly saw the nature, saw the unelaborateness, something that is unseeable. When I'm saying looking directly, and at that same time you have to rest, relaxed. It's like sitting there, just let it settle. First you're looking directly, then immediately you just send that, then you can do that, just let it be. Just let it be, rest letting it be. When we grasp a hot bodhisattva, we just leave it right there, let it be. And so that is leaving it there. You seeing the temperature just leaving it there, doesn't it? And see the nature that has been leaving it as it is. I see in the nature, and because it is the thing doesn't mean a thing, all the phenomena of samsara and nirvana can be called things. Everything that we know is we talk about them. That is what we mean by thing. When we talk about thing, this means all of the phenomena of samsara and nirvana. All the phenomena that appear to the mind, and call that things, and seeing the nature of all things and realizing that they're empty. And when you see that nature, then what do we need to do? And so that we don't grasp at it too much, we just relaxed. Resting and relaxing and grasping your space. You just relax and rest. When you see the nature, then you relax the mind. When you relax like this, then you're grasping your own place. And this is important. Cutting through the root and grasping your place. And when you cut through the root, if you fall over with it, then somebody you've got the business, then you grasp your own place. And when you cut the breath and you're able to grasp it, then this is the most profound point about Mahamudra. As Gutsampa says, cut through the root, grasp your own. So you need to cut through the root, that's important, but you need to also grasp your own space. So grasp your own space. Once you've grasped your own place, whatever good or bad conditions are unable to make kind of sentence. So then you've grasped your own position. Now that we have to gain our own foothold or grasp our own place, when you see things that are bad, we'd have all the consumption. We go to the because that condition. Then we have the greed and hatred arise from that. But that's a sign that we are not able to actually grow up. So when we let it alone, and we grasp our own spot, and then when we just letting things be and grasping our own space, then. When we have our helping our friends or pleasant friends and our hateful and our harmful enemies, I think that I cannot be taken away over to the by I cannot be distracted by my thoughts of greed or hatred because I have grasped my own place and it's a good man place, and so letting things being seeing the nature when you've seen the nature of things done because then you are not able to the enemies can't do anything to nature, they can't do anything to nature. So when Gampopa described Gampopa gave an explanation of that Mahamudra, he says, and so when you realize that all phenomena of Mahamudra, that means the Chak, and the Chakya Chempo or Mahamudra. So when it doesn't transcend nature, that is the Gya. If you know that the nature of all things, then that is the great. And these three characteristics of the word, Chagya Chempo or Mahamudra. And if you're able to realize that all phenomena, samsara, nirvana, do not transcend, not manuta, that is chat. Everything that you see, everything that appears, and what is it, all the phenomena that there are, if you're able to rest without them, within the luminous nature, and they cannot be. And there are many different conditions that might disturb you and distract you, but if you're resting within the natural state living you, altered by the condition of conceptualization, then that is the gya, the word gya in Chagya Champo or Mahamudra. And if you realize then this is the Dharma nature is self liberated, then this is the Champo or Maha in the word Mahamudra. Relax and grasp your own seat, and then when you do, and then just do, and then at that point let. And some of you don't, when you realize whatever happens at that point, whatever conception happens, then you don't follow what do you think is good and what finds that they can all be, they can all be just liberated in the Dharma tradition, this is said. So just be, they can all be liberated, let the river of thoughts be purified. And so then give them up completely, just throw them away completely. So all your suspicions, no thought, throw them away completely. Then they're you cut through them. So you have two things that are associated. If you jump from one to another, then you've, so if you're jumping across an abyss, if they're close, if you can complete with it, if you just give them up completely and jump across the abyss. And so then you do not need to fear the places, the lower realms, the hells, and the hungry ghosts and animals. You don't have any hope for whatever it is, like what wells up in the Dharma nature, what wells up in Mahamudra. And so this is all just the... and so at that point, you have just cut through all of the conceptualization. Recognize that the Buddha is your own mind. So knowing, this is the same as saying deciding that your mind doesn't. So recognizing that the Buddha is your own mind, and deciding that the Buddha is your mind. Whether the Buddha is not something accidental, but if you realize that that is in your mind, then you think, I have no hope for samsara nirvana, no hope for the result. I have no thought of the result. I think this is something going to change. May I become a Buddha in the future? May I become a Namish in the future? May I realize the result? And it's not... then it's not something that's just a mental aspiration. It's something that is being manifest for us and that we recognize. Knowing the Buddha's own mind, I have no mental aspiration for mind. Someone who says, rest and relaxing in the last word, benesu, if the bonds are loose, there's no doubt you'll be freed. There is no need to doubt this. We'll continue with this in the next session. Now, remind yourself well of bodhicitta as you listen. This is Ganjan's Mahamudra Telopara, called the Mahamudra Purusha, the epiphany is called Ganjan's. I prostrate to the glorious Vajra, intelligent number who endures hardship, respects the Guru, and prayer something. You are fortunate, take this to heart. Mahamudra cannot be shown, just as who can show space to whom. Likewise, listening to the show in the nature of Mahamudra. Relax and rest in an unaltered basic nature. If the bonds are loosed, there's no doubt you'll be freed. If the bonds are loosed, so what's bound is the body. We need to relax what is bound. Many thoughts have bound the nature of our mind is the self-aware wisdom, the luminous nature. But the connections have bound it and tied it up in the way they've tied it. There's not recognizing the expression of the recognition that this is the energy of this, and we cling to them as things, and we don't recognize self-awareness as awareness of ourself, and then we cling to that as being a self, and then because of this fixation, then we are bounding up. We have bound our own selves up. We have bound ourselves. It's not like this, like some other other condition that has bound us. It's like the water swelling. But when you border the water, it's like you are stuck inside of it. It can't go up out of it. So we bound ourselves with our. Now, normally, what we normally think is that we are always hoping or fearing something. We call ourselves predictions. I say, I'm a meditator. I'm a great meditator. And we say, I'm practicing. But as we say this, but we still have always these hopes, always have hopes and fears. In particular, of those of doing our internal practice, in the practice that we think, it says we have to, We should be abundant with the child. We need to wear the mistas, our clothes. We need to give up everything we need to and do our practice focus. Without any thought or hopes or expression for this life at all, knowing that possessions and sensory pleasures are essenceless, and that grasping at them and using them is improper and inappropriate. And thinking and realizing this, we need to spend our time practice. In particular for us Kajubas, holding the lineage of the Gaudasana, from the Dhammakaya Vajradhara to our Gurudvajra, the practice of this meaning image is it does not depend on day and night. Distinguishing from day and night, whatever happens on this practice, whatever adverse circumstance occurs, we bring it into our practice. No matter what the bad or good circumstances, we aren't distracted by that. We are able to make it into practice. And so this is a particular feature of the practice of the Kadampas, and of especially the Mahamudra tradition that comes from the Panchen Naropa. So when we talk about it in Kajubha, then it's just a name. It's just like the fixation on a particular Dharma tradition. But there's no particular feature to it. It doesn't have the special features. And what the special features are is we have the practice for this entire life that was emphasized by Gampopa, the practice for the entire lifetime that Gampopa taught. But forgetting about practice, it's difficult for us to forget about that. It's difficult for us even to think about impairments. We always, we don't realize it. When we recite these, and when we recite the military Guru Puja, then we say, oh, sorry, bless me on this very seat, bless me in this mission, bless me right now, bless me in this seat. What session? What was it? We don't even sit in. We don't even sit on the cushion. If we sit there for 5 minutes, then we get up and go someplace. We don't have no time to sit. There's no time for us to do this. We spend our entire day wandering around. And so on this very seat means on this minute. It's like a stake that is planted in the ground, staying there, and it's staying there until you achieve the resolution, realization. You're staying on that same state. The last instruction that Milarepa says, I have this pithamistress, and so if he gives it, and he gives it this, and he looks, showed his buttocks, and then Gambopa looked at his buttocks, and looked at what he showed. So you can sit. You can sit on a place, and sit on the cushions, and practice with fortitude. That are going up and going, then never staying there. Do not be like that. It'll create obstacles. You need, with fortitude and dedication, you need to sit in the same place and practice it. And until you leave this seat, you need to be to develop the qualities of abandonment and realization. Practice it. This is the final instruction that is given, and we all know this. And we say, I'm Kajupa. This is not a question of a Dharma tradition. It's not a question of functionality. It's the lineage that you have received, and practicing that, and then becoming like that guru. Becoming like that spiritual master. Become like the great beings who uphold that lineage, and then becoming that times, and in order to become the being just like them, we do this practice. So when we realize the unaltered basic nature, so whenever I die, I am able to take death as the practice. And so next, and we always say in orally, I can go die at any time. We say, I don't need to make any preparations. I've already made my preparations. We say this, right? How would you do that? So from the time, because we need to keep the gurus and prith instructions in our mind. And particularly the practice of Mahamudra that has been passed off from Tilopa to Naropa, we need to incorporate it into the contentment of our mind. And if we're able to make it so that it can benefit ourselves and benefit other sentient beings, then we are able, the particular features of the Kajuka come from that. And so this is, and being able to uphold the lineage of all the Buddhists. Another way of saying they're part of the Buddhists, that's in this lineage, it doesn't help. It makes it say, I was like a child of the mud, I was able to do this, I can live on the mountains, I can take something, we can, no matter how broadly you publish this, it doesn't benefit you. You need to be able to put it into practice, you need to put it into practice. And so these two lines are needed. They talk about the way that we practice in terms of the outline or the topics, as they call them, in practice. Relax and rest in an understood background. If the bonds are loosed, there's no doubt you'll be freed. So if you ask, what is the practice of Mahamudra? The response to it is this. Relax and rest in the unaltered basic nature. Whenever you must relax the altered basic nature of mind, if a thought occurs, don't follow the thoughts, grasping at it. Instead, look directly at it. Let it alone, and cut through it. And then, if you're able to do it, then you'll be able to recognize that the Buddha is your mind, as Milarepa said. First, you look at it directly. This is important, right? Look directly and see the nature, and see that the unelaborateness is like space. Then let it alone, and relax. So relaxing and resting. When we're talking about relax and rest, we can relax and rest. When you're doing the decision, we've got to pretend that everything is samsara, nirvana, but when we get out of the session, then if we're not careful about our conduct, then when those inappropriate inputs are awakened, then once again we are able to return back to it. So when we look directly, and by letting go, by looking directly and by letting low, then the benefit is that when we relax in our conduct of body, speech, and mind, then we will not lose ourselves in the ordinary. We'll be able to hold our place. As a practitioner has to be able to hold your place. So when a condition happens, if you're unable to hold your own place, it doesn't benefit you. And in order for that to happen, so you need to wait for the condition. If you don't be careful until these situation to the extent, and then when that happens, and then apply the impetus. And so if that's difficult, so for that you need to meditate. You need to transfer in methods, train yourself in the path, and so forth. And so that when there's no apprehension and no suspicions, and this becomes from our continual practice, our continual conduct, our continual training. Our continuous, because of a continued applying carefulness and mindfulness and awareness, then we'll be able to develop that capacity. If we're always reckoning, then when a circumstance is, and you think, oh no, what's best for me to do? Which is looking back then, look for some from protection, then that's difficult. And so for that reason, as Milarepa said, when you relax and rest, it's not thinking anything about it, without any grasping at anything, whatever thought occurs, just without changing it, just relax and rest. And then if you're able to grasp your own place then it's fine. So we need to grasp our own spot. That is the essence point. Because we're unable to grasp our own spot, our own place, that we have difficulty in circumstances. And so when we are unable to grasp it, we need to have difficulty. So therefore it says relax and rest and grasp it. And so this is, purifies the visitors. So the degenerate will go to its own place, the clear will go to its own place, and when we confront the thoughts, when I think a thought, and you're afraid when the thought's going to happen, and when the thought is going to occur, and if you're afraid of that, then there's no way that you can that the thought would be different. So you need to throw it completely away. You have to throw it away. So it says, come throw it away completely, and what does this benefit? Then it cuts all of your thoughts. All of your erroneous thoughts are cut. When we try to throw things away, if we have no meditation, we throw things within it, then everything comes back back on us completely. What's it? We throw it over there, and then it comes back. Now that's difficult. And so this is the disgrace of the great mantra. This is a meditative phenomenon. When a signature center, then you throw them away. Then when they listen, you give them, but then you throw them away completely. Then you think about it, and then you thought the thoughts. And when you thought has thought, then you don't need to fear falling into hell, into the honey ghost, the animals, and stuff. That is cut, then you're liberated in one place. And so that is recognizing your nature as mind. Your mind is Buddha, and so forth. And so then at that point, you have no wish or things. You have no wishes. You have no help or fear of avoiding samsara or achieving nirvana. And so when we do like, we need to relax. We need to relax the thoughts that bind us, and it's looking directly. Relax. There's those three. When they first create, look at them directly. This is the sequence of practice. When you look at it, the practice, then you leave it alone. Once you've seen the unelaborate, then you just leave it alone. Without any effort, you just leave it alone. When by leaving it alone, you can know the emptiness nature of all things. When we recognize it. But then if you are attached to attentiveness, if you're fixated on emptiness, and this is a wrong view that cannot be cured. So if you get, there are many thoughts, many faults that come from clinging to emptiness, and so you just relax and hold your space. So that is like a retreat. So that is the important thing to hold in your place. So if you're always practicing with attachment and treasuring, whenever circumstances, they have to be able to make them into enhancements of our practice. And in order for that to happen, when we do that, then we need to achieve control over ourselves. We have to have control. We have to gain control over our minds. And if we gain control over our mind, then in order to do that, we need first to cut through all our projections. And we need to, it's not from outside, we need to cut through them from the inside. If we cut through the projections from the inside, then we are freed from the hopes and fears and from dualism. And that sort of yogi, can separate the purity and impurity of the river of thoughts, and there's no doubt that there will be liberation. No, there's in the song of Saraha, in his Mahamudra songs, it says Kyeho. If you realize the nature of your own mind, if you realize the suchness of your mind, first it says, Geho, or wondrous. Look at your own mind without being distracted. If you realize the nature of your own suchness, then the mind will appear as Mahamudra, and you will feel the great bliss of self-liberation. So Geho means how wondrous, and the reason why you're astounded is because something you've never seen before. When you haven't received the pith instructions, you haven't practiced it, and you haven't seen it. When you receive the instructions from the guru and you practice them at one point, then you see the qualities that you're like, you see the instructions like this, and you say, oh, this is my mistake, this is lost, and not fun. It's like recognizing, so much that you recognize the qualities, and it's how wondrous, it's like amazing. Undistracted. And distracted means that you can't be distracted at all. As it says in here, if bonds are loosed, it says in here, or if you relax and rest, then liberated. If you relax and rest, then you need to grasp one person. So here's it says, if bonds are loosed, and here's the same word. So the undistracted is very important. When you talk about Mahamudra in the Vajrapatara lineage prayer, it says the gate. The main practice is being undistracted, as it's taught, as one who whatever arises rests simply, not altering just that freshens of essence of thought, but blesses with the practice that's free of compassion. That is the same as in the Keho, without being distracted, look at your own mind. So then being distracted means don't fall into frail prey to circumstances. Don't fall prey to circumstances. If we are distracted by our desires, if we're distracted by our thoughts of hatred and delusion and so forth, but when they are subside into their nature, and when we transcend these, if we are able to make the 24 hours of the day into the yogic practice, it's like the yoga of eating, the yoga of doing, the yoga of sleeping. Then when you arise, the practice of waking up and luminescence. And if we're able to make all our meditation and most meditation sessions into practice, then it's good. But we must not be distracted. And so for that reason, to look at our own self, look at ourselves. And so when you look, it's not like there's some mind that is separate and then a mind that is looking at separate. It's not like that. When a thought arises, then just leave it alone in that, leave it as it is, and within that, and being undistracted. That there's nothing to look at or looking. So undistracted, look at your own matter. When you realize your own suchness, if you can see it, if you can know, if you can be aware of it, if you recognize it, then even the distracted mind arises as a Mahamudra. And this is the result of the practice. Even if you're distracted, even that distracted mind can become Mahamudra, is within Mahamudra. It's not like your mind has gone outside someplace else. It's that the distracted mind itself it is, can occur as Mahamudra. So the point of Mahamudra is this, right? It's as it is said. So the distracted mind becomes Mahamudra. The distracted mind then also becomes liberated as Mahamudra, and it can dawn in that. And so that you come to the self-liberation. When you come to that self-liberation, then the great bliss is day and night is continuous day and night, and everything subsides into this. Then all of your conduct of going and staying and so forth, there's no obstacles at all. It's when our mind is distracted that there are obstacles. It's our thoughts that are the obstacles. With the obstructions of our predication, the obstructions of our thoughts and so forth. When we're able to sustain the nature of mind, no matter what it is arises, then at that point, then we see that it's like the waves and water come out of the water. In the end, they subside into the waters. And so, if whenever it arises, then that can dissolve, subside into the Dharma nature. Then that is great bliss. And so, this bond is, if bonds are loosed, there's no freed. You can be freed, and the way you can be freed is not to be bound by the characteristics of thought, but without any resting, leaving it as it is, sustaining as it is, and with the view with it, you can continue this, sustain it with the certainty. Then you'll develop the conviction in this, and then you'll definitely be liberated. If bonds are loosed, there's no doubt you'll be freed. And so this is how we practice it. And this is practice how we do it in our conduct. And so we always say, I practice, even if you say I'm practicing, but even so, we still need it. It should go in this way. Relax and rest in the unknotted bolster's sweat. So at all times, we should just let the mind be as it is. Just let it be. Let it be fresh. Don't change it. It's easier. So when a thought happens, what do we need to do? If a thought happens, what should I do? What is it? Yeah, there's nothing to do, no problem. You need to know that this thought is self-liberated. If you know the point that the thoughts are self-liberated, then you'll be liberated. If you take an external entity, and if you put the thought to be limited over here, and you try to destroy it with another thought, there's no way that you can stop the thought. Is there a time that can thought exist? And when is that time? It is when you recognize that thoughts are the Dharma nature, then they'll be liberated. So you need to know that thoughts are the Dharma nature. And if you understand that, if you think about each single thought, the nature of the mind, the nature of the Dharmata must be found within the thoughts. There's nowhere else a place we can find it. The thoughts are really very close. This is why we say that thoughts are very important. So this is not saying that the attached mind of actual desire, hatred, and so forth. It's not that. It's the nature of the pure nature of desire, the pure nature of hatred. By looking with the mind that investigates it properly, then we can say that it can never departs, comes to or leaves from the nature of all things, and to recognize that is the self-liberation of all characteristics. And so this is how we supplicate from to become self-liberated. And this is when the basis of this is in this understanding, on this basis, in this order, and in this, but we need to supplicate in this way. This is the basis for in which we have to develop bodhicitta and develop love and history. So like when you do say the peaceful and wrathful deities, we say, so I go for retitude, when you say that I prostrate to the channels and winds and so forth, then that's, I'm talking about this. It's not that. It's understanding the nature that we need to do. Otherwise, it's different. It's knowing the nature. We're talking about the talking about the pure nature and talking about the impure. And we need to be able to distinguish between these two, and by that intelligence being able to someone that goes stronger and stronger, then at some point we get to the impure, then we recognize that the impure has that the nature of the net that we can say that there's nothing to eliminate, and then we are able to distinguish between, then we've transcended the idea of need to, we have transcended what needs to be, we have transcended what needs to be. So it's like as Jamgon says, I prostrate to devotees, I prostrate to the gurus, I prostrate to the hells, I prostrate to the hungers. So this is a very distinct thing. This is like a very strange thing to say. It's like you've maybe gone crazy, or it's like you're you always pray that we won't be sent, but when you say, I prostrate to the hells, I prostrate to the hungry ghosts, I prostrate to the animals. If you're unable to, if you're going to practice, and if you practice desire, practice it, and he's saying, this is like the insanity, this is a crazy standard, if you look at it from a worldly level. When a yogi looks at it, desire is self-limited, hatred is self-limited, the delusions under, and when we get to that point, then we can prostrate to greed, hatred, and desire. Then we're put up to actual desire, put into the nature of the discriminating wisdom, and so forth. And we realize that they never depart from the expanse of the five wisdoms, and we understand that we get some, and when we eliminate all our misconceptions and projections about them, then that's what it is. So then when you understand, then it's no different prostrating to desire, it's no different for prostrating to the nature of discriminating Western. There's no difference, it's just words. And so for a yogi, the words are not important. The names, the terms and the terminology and so forth that are important is important is looking at the nature and seeing that. And so in that kind of a situation of that nature, if we know that, it's what it says, if bonds are loose, there's no doubt you'll be afraid. This is the way we practice. Now following this, just as when you look in the center of space, seeing stops, likewise, when the mind looks at mind, thoughts cease and unexcelled enlightenment is achieved. These are the words. And the meaning of these words, what it shows is, at this point, it talks about how to sustain letting it be. Sustain letting it be, or sustain the natural state, or how to sustain the nature of mind. How to maintain our practice, how to sustain our letting it be, or sustain letting be, I should say. Just as when you look in the center of space, seeing stops, when you look at the center of space, you can look in it, but there's nothing that you can see there. When you look at the center of space, the characteristics of space, and the shape of space, and the color of space, and the nature of it, there can't be seen. Seeing stops. You look, and there's nothing to see, so you can experience that. When you look in the center of space, seeing stops. Likewise, when the mind looks at mind, we just say the mind looks at mind. We said, when it's talking about the mind looks at mind, there's actually not really looking as a mind actually looking at mind, but it is maintaining that nature. Sustaining the mind in equipoise. Is sustaining the nature of mind, sustaining the ordinary mind, as Kampopa said. The ordinary, what does that mean? It means ordinary, it means regular. Something that's unchanged, just the left alone, sustain the ordinary mind that is not changed or altered. Sustain the ordinary mind. The attachment to the said, may the clinging of experiences be good as good and be naturally liberated. May that be the clinging to experience is good, and the clinging to experience not letting that to bind their material experience and not abandon through by the antidote, but recognizing that. that attachment is naturally liberated. It's like an ice cube melting into water. That ice, because of the condition of cold weather, because of cold weather, because of electricity, because of that that icing does not turn into, because of but because of circumstance it appears as well. If free of those conditions of cold, or because of the electrically manufactured cold, then it returns to its original nature, which is water, and then it goes returns to water. May clinging to experiences be as good, be naturally liberated. May the delusion of thoughts being bad be purified in the expanse. The delusion of thoughts is not something that needs to be changed. You just recognize that it's purified in the expanse. And these two, the good thoughts and bad thoughts, and when those are when those perish, and what is left? The ordinary mind. That is what left. Ordinary mind means is the ground of all sentient beings. It is the nature of all sentient beings. It is the nature of all sentient beings that is inseparable from the Buddhas. There is nothing to give up, nothing to take in, nothing to give up, nothing to add. There's nothing to add, nothing to lose or gain. There's no samsaric phenomena to remove or nirvanic phenomena to add. May ordinary medicine with nothing to remove or add lose again. So as it says here, likewise, when the mind looks at mind, thoughts cease and unexcelled enlightenment is engaged. If the thoughts cease means, isn't it, that they just completely perish? It's like that they are laterally liberated. The clinging to them existing, the clinging to things being true. Think that if things are, then we come at clinging as things are emptiness, we are attached to them as being emptiness, that is also a fault. Whatever we cling to something as being existing or non-existing, or being or not being, then whatever fixation we have is affirmed. And so all of the thoughts cease, and then naturally all naturally subside. At the end of the 60 stanzas of reasoning is what it says. So when you have gone to the point where you're never moved by thoughts, and so when you have the thought to think of something as emptiness, it is unelaborated, it has no nature, and you're thinking that, and that thought, and not even moved by that sort of a thought, and when the thoughts are then when all the thoughts of things being existing or not existing and so forth, then we will be able to, when those are naturally subsided, we'll be able to cross through the ocean of of existence. And so as it says here, thought cease and unexcelled enlightenment is achieved. When you say cease, there are many ways to understand this. It's because of there's one way of talking about using an antidote to cause the make thought cease. But there are many different ways, but it's one of the, when the mind looks at mind, the reason is it. So here it's telling the shots, and when it's showing the reason, if your mind looked at it properly, and if you looked at the mind, and if you're able to look at your mind with mind, you're able to sustain that essence, then you don't need to particularly apply an antidote to stop the thought. Then the thought will subside of their own. They will be pacified where they are. The thoughts will cease. The thoughts are naturally pacified. When we talk about the thoughts, now these thoughts, when we talk about these are thoughts that we grasp as being true. As long as we grasp what thoughts as being thoughts, then all of the different faults can occur. Then all the faults and the problems can occur. And becomes because we grasp at thoughts as being thoughts, and if we just generally thoughts being there being there is not a problem. This is said in many different pith instructions. When you're talking about these thoughts, the thoughts that cease is not just thought in general, but it is the thoughts that we particularly grasp at, or that we initially grasp at it. That is what we insist on, and that thought, when we look at it in our mind, then the thoughts naturally subside into the Dharma nature, then there's no problem with there being any general thoughts. We aren't practicing because we don't need thoughts. We don't meditate in order that thoughts don't occur. We don't meditate by looking at our thoughts or thoughts. We don't We don't meditate with the hope that the thoughts will stop and we'll have developed some qualities. I think this thought is okay. We don't meditate saying, I need to stop these thoughts, that they are obstructions for me. What it is even though the thoughts, we are not affected by the thoughts. Even though the thoughts, we are not obstructed by the thoughts. And if we have the thoughts and they do not prevent us from being in meditative equipoise, then that is the type of meditation we have. It's that fixation. That fixation, and that first attachment, that first exhibit, that is what it creates obstructions for us. They do not, thoughts in themselves do not generally make sense. As has it said in a song in the ocean of Kagyu songs. So Sato has given up all of the collection of gathering wealth and stuff, gathering things in our under mattresses and under our tables and so forth. We lock them up and put them in a box. And then we put a second lock on that. Then we put a third lock on top of that second lock. And then we gather more and more wealth. And the clothes we have, the summer clothes, winter clothes, spring clothes, and autumn clothes. And then we have many things and we get them. And not only do we have to have possessions, that we have to have good possessions, and we have things that are never separate from, we gather, then that fixation to us, and then our attachment to those is what obscures us. And so this is what the master Ngudup Jalsin once said. And for him, he says, I have given up keeping things. This means I have no attachment to things, no attachment, no fixation on things, possessions, food and clothing. For a yogi who has not, who's given up the business, then given up fixation on gathering things, then all of the good things that we see are all the good things you might see, the gold and silver and so forth. Leaving them in an empty place, a place where only wild animals like deers and boars and so forth. If there's a place where there are flowers and where there are parks, and a place where you have crops, and if you leave it there, if a boar comes in it, then you go out with a stick. A boar has come and they're going to eat my crops. They're going to eat my flowers, and then that gives us difficulty. That's what it is. I don't have that, is what he said. For me, the yogi who has no attachment to gathering things, whether I have them is good, whether I don't have them is okay. If I have things, it's fine. And if I filled this entire temple with gold, it'd be fine, but I have no attachment to it. If I have it, it's fine. The most important thing is being free of attachment within yourself. Now that is what then is naturally embedded. If you have no attachment to this, not to things better, then there's no benefit or harm from attachment to things. And so it is the attachment being liberated from inside. It's not saying things means not that there are no thoughts. It means that they just leave them alone. Then the thoughts do not obscure us. There's no difference if thoughts have thoughts. For example, a yogi, when he's getting to a high level of practice, then it's even better when there are thoughts. The more thoughts there, then all of those thoughts, are, no matter how many they are, can become aids in our practice. When there is a forest that catches fire, the more wind there is, the better help it is to the fire. And if there's no fire, no wind, then it can't spread. So it's like for the yogi who is practicing, then no matter adversity appears as aids in practice. No matter the more that happens, the more adversity they have, the more it becomes aids in our practice. So it's Bicheng are, and so that type of yogi is able to transform the obstacles into practice. And it's like, otherwise you don't say, you know, tell all the spirits, so come here, it is come to visit. If you think, you'd have to be someone who has the power and the ability, someone who has the able to practice and it has the particular abilities of practice, someone is able to overcome their obstructions over their practice and be able to transform them in practice. Otherwise, for us ordinary people, if we don't have that and say, let the obstacle, something just creates problems for us. And so for that reason, all of the obstructing spirits and so forth can be like Dharma protects and so forth. So because the power of a practice, we've developed a power of the nature of things, and this is a sign of developing practice as a result of the practice, so we don't look at the thoughts as nature. So this is extremely important when we're doing the practice of Mahamudra. It's also the same in the chit practice. I'm going to talk about the real main basis of Chöpodism. The individual who practices chit does not view their own mind as a demon. Viewing your mind as a demon is an obstacle to practice. And what that means is clinging to your ego, clinging to a self. That is the... This is the four thoughts. There's the thought. So there is the thought of the self that is the root of existence. That thought of the self. We realize that that is the Mara or the demon. We realize that all of the adversity comes happening to all because of that. All obstacles happen because of it. Everything that happens come from that. And so the actual Mara is ego clinging. And so for that reason, we're talking about thought cease. Means recognizing the nature of thoughts, knowing the nature of thoughts correctly, and then no matter how many there are, then they're naturally liberated. They're naturally liberated into the Dharma nature. And so that the thought cease and unexcelled enlightenment is achieved. Just as clouds of mist dissipate into the expanse of sky, not going anywhere, not staying anywhere, so it is with thoughts arising in your mind. Seeing your own mind purifies the waves of thought. And just as clouds of mist dissipate into the expanse of the sky, In the context of Mahamudra, what it's taught is stillness and motion. We talk about stillness and motion, these two. Often we talk about stillness, motion, and awareness, these three, right? Stillness, motion, and then the awareness of its nature. We talk about the stillness, emotion, and awareness. And here it's stillness and awareness. And here it's talking about not stillness and awareness, it's talking about motion. So among these three, it is motion. It's a motion. This is the motion is with motion within the Dhamma nature. But the thoughts occurring, the motion, if you know the nature, they are liberated. So when the thoughts move or when thoughts occur, then knowing how that they dissolve into the Dharma expanse. And when we speak about this, and so it's going to, there's a citation I could give, but that'll come later as well. I'm going to talk about how they are the moving to destructive. It's just as, when you talk about how motion is liberated in the Dhamma expanse, it's just as the clouds of mist dissipate in the expanse of the sky. So talking about the way that that motion is dissolves into the Dhamma nature. And so as it says above, just as when you look at the center of space, seeing stops, the nature, the mind looks at mind, the thoughts cease, and the enlightenment is. It's like we talk the co-emergent mind essence is the Dharmakaya, and the unceasing appearances are the play of the Dharmakaya. And so when you realize that thoughts cease, this is talking about what this teaches is the co-emergent mind essence, the Dharmakaya. Later, when it talks about the co-emergent appearances as the light of the Dharmakaya. So when we talk about this, let's talk about the two different worlds. It talks about the 12 types of motion, the self-purification of motivation. Talk motion means the motion or the occurrence of thought. You recognize when that is liberated in the Dharmata, and so this is the self-liberation of motion. So the clouds that naturally dissipate, and that is similar, that is self-purified or self-dissipating. When you talk about the self-liberation of thoughts, and talk just as the clouds of mist dissipate in the sky, if a mist from the ground, you know, that because it comes originally from the clouds, and it eventually goes down into the ground. It dissipates into the sky, expanse of the sky. When it's dissipated in the sky, not going anywhere, not staying anywhere. The mist, where does it go? Where did it disappear? Where did it stay? If you examine this, you can't find anywhere. It hasn't gone anywhere. It hasn't stayed anywhere. So it is with the thoughts arising from your mind, the thoughts in your mind that occur from your mind, virtuous, unvirtuous, or neutral. Many thoughts occur. All the thoughts occur in the mind. They do not need to be defeated with an antidote. It's by seeing the nature of mind. Where they come from is they come from your mind. So they come out of your mind. And so when you come to strike the important points of the mind, then because of this, then the waves of thoughts subside. Just as waves subside into the ocean, the thoughts arising from mind purified in the like the seeing your own mind purifies the waves of thought. So if you see the nature of mind, then there is no need to particularly liberate there is no need to particularly eliminate thoughts. You just let them subside on their own. They're self purifying. If you know the way that they're liberated on the ambassador, just resting in the natural state of your mind and without changing it, you have the conviction of the view and the level of the practice, and when you sustain the nature of whatever it is arises, then it'll all be subside into the nature of the mind. In a Doha of Saraha, it says, if there's not even the slightest separation in sky and the nature of the mind, then the word separation is just an adventitious label. And this is sort of, in this way, the mind, if three things, the mind, space, and the dharmata, these three are one in essence. They cannot be separated. Cannot be indifferent. They are not affected by conditions. They cannot be changed by circumstance. If you, in the nature of how things are, they're the same. If you recognize that your mind has the same similarities to space, then there's no separation. But there is some separation. The separation is that this is the mind, this is the space, this is the Dharma nature, is something separate. If you say that, then that is false. That the separate names are just temporary names that you're giving. It's just thoughts that you're projecting with them. But actually, there is no separation of the two. So the separation is just projected by mind. So when you say the thoughts cease, the thoughts of them being separated also needs to cease. So within our mind, with our mind space and the Dharma nature, there is no separation at all. Then he's saying that the separate is just given by the Nebbit. This is only a fictitious false word. So that saying that they're separate is just a fiction. So this is just a logical way of grasping that. It's not something that exists in the nature. So it is with the thoughts arising from your mind. Seeing your own mind purifies the thoughts. If you know the point of minds being self-liberating, then you have realization. If you do not know that, then the realization is obscured. When a yogi practices, what point they have to know? They need to know the point of letting thoughts be liberating upon arising. Thoughts arise. The thoughts occur. There's no problem with that. But you don't need to fixate on them. But then if you know that, then they can be liberated. It's like, if you know that, and it's like a snow falling onto a hot rocks, and the moment that, and when the, if snow falls on a hot, if snow falls on a hot rock, then it automatically limerates. If we know this point about this, this point about the thoughts being liberated when they arise, then they, then we realize that they're just the, what wells up out of the, they're just a display of the Dharma nature. And so when they're talking about it, so they're talking about the thoughts cease in above, when it's talking about seeing your own mind purifies the ways of thought, come to the same point. Get me one. And so does seeing the thoughts of the mind, arise from the mind, seeing your own mind, if you see them, if they're able to pacify, and you see your own nature of the mind, then that, this purifies from the thoughts of that, so it purifies the nature of the mind here. Because when they, because of the condition of wind, there are the thought, there are the big ways, and when there are no wind, then their thoughts. So no matter what thought is, if you know the point about them arising, arising, liberation upon arising, then there's no problem for the yogi. To let them happen or not. For a yoga, then they can realize that thoughts are great kindness, and they can become an enhancement for the practice. When Milarepa said, when thoughts arise from inside, we say thought, then we talk about the, then it talks about the, so if you don't know how to talk about, if you don't really understand the way the words work, then some of the pith instructions don't have any point. When you talk about the words of the, talk about the philosophical terms, if you don't understand. When you talk about that, the word realization, if you realize, realizing and knowing, it's an understanding of realizing, there's sometimes when it means that. Sometimes we talk about realization. It can also, can talk about, can talk about it as realization is not knowing. Also, when some realization says, so when Milarepa says that the realization arises from inside, so this here means the confidence of liberation, that strength of that, the level of conviction of them. When that conviction of realization, then it's like the sun shining shining in the darkness, or it's like turning on the light in the darkness. The moment that the light, the moment that the light shines, at the moment that the light, that the sun shines, you don't need to try to bring in some other external advent, particularly to overcome the darkness. Just merely the light shining completely eliminates all of the darkness inside of the inside the house. And so this is the, and so this is the same. Seeing your own mind purifies of inside is the same. And so these are the same. The same as in the quote from Milarepa. When realization arises from inside, there's not, saying inside doesn't mean from within our chest. It means in our within our experience, from within our experience. It doesn't mean to come up from our bodies. From our bodies, it's not that. In the inside, from within, does not mean from within our practice. The external would be just mere understanding from, because of scripture and realization and intelligence. If you did, if you go for refuge in that reason, then it is external. But here is from when you it comes from the experience of your relations, and that is from within, having that conviction coming to it. It's like the sun shining in darkness. It's when the sun shines in darkness, the thoughts and afflictions, and about the afflictions is here. Afflictions means the incorrect minds. It can be understood as any, and so afflictive thoughts are cast out without altering them. We don't have to think this is a good thought, this is a bad thought, and we need to keep. We don't need to think this is a good thought, we need to keep. This is a bad thought, we need to eliminate. They're just natural inhibitors. They're just cast out on earth. We don't need to change them. We don't need to use an external antidote. Just recognizing them. Just developing meditation within our mind streams. When to develop, when is it? When the moment that realization arises, when we realization, the moment they recognize it, when to develop confidence, then we don't need to use another antidote. We don't need to use another artificial antidote. By seeing our own mind, purifies the ways of thoughts. In the Mahamudra, when we talk about dissolving in its own place, liberating its own space. This is a very important word. It's a very word that has a lot of blessings. Because of the points of practice, recognize that you don't have to use an external antidote. Right, that very spot, it is able to liberate it right there, in this very continuum, wherever you are, you're able to be able to relax into the original nature. This is very important. It's also in Dzogchen, right? It is also self-arising, self-liberation. This is also talked about. If you do not know the points about self-arising, self-liberation, then you won't be able to grasp the nature place of this. This is in not just Dzogchen, it's the same as. You need to know the point of self-liberated upon on arising. Then you won't be able to grasp. You won't be able to gather this, grasp the stronghold of meditation, and if you can grasp the stronghold of then you don't. If you grasp then we'll be able to practice wherever you are, and you don't have to close the methods, close the doors, and close your windows, and so forth, and close everything. You can do it. So when you do your sessions, you know you practice. It's like you're always inside your sessions, and you practice well, and then you go outside, and there are like people. So when you talk about sessions and post-meditation, then it's very difficult. When we are practicing the practicing Mahamudra, if you're a yogi who is practicing the Mahamudra, then you don't need to distinguish between meditation and post-meditation. Then if you're able to sustain the nature of your mind within all these other with the situation wherever you're going, whatever you're doing, then that is a practice. If you are overcome by those, there's no way you can ever get to self-liberation. In the same way, with stillness and motion, stillness means when thoughts are not occurring, when the mind is resting, relaxed, without any thought occurring, free of thoughts. When there are no thoughts, that is stillness. And when a thought occurs, that is motion, occurrence. Until we can eliminate the distinction between stillness and motion, then we won't be able to achieve the stronghold of meditation. We need to overcome this. There's a bit of a wall between the two. There's one side of this, one side, and there's this side, and you have this side and that side, and because of that wall, this is what happens, right? When you talk about this side and that side, who made it? It was made by that wall. Because of that wall, there's the other side, and then this side, And the difference is by midway. If you can destroy that, if it falls down, then there's no question. Then that projection of there being this side and that side is gone. There's no this side or that anymore. So so this is made by our dualistic thoughts. And therefore, because of that dualistic thought, we have samsara and thought. We put a wall there, and a good and bad thought. We have another wall. Us and other. Self and other, one and other, samsara and nirvana, stopping and arising, going and coming. All of these thoughts are because of that boundary thing. We need to destroy that boundary. We need to destroy that. But it's not by using another antidote. It's by knowing the nature of being self, being self-liberated. And if we understand that it's liberated from self, and then there's no different. It's this between stillness and motion. Because within the stillness there can be motion. Within there's emotion, there is a stillness, and eventually you get to the point where there is no difference between the two. And for that is for us right now. There's not the point. There's shamatha. We have to practice shamatha. I can't sit at all. The thoughts, and one thought after occurs, one falls after another, And that's something I think. And you think, I forget about being able to meditate in the mind. I'm not even going to find any find any peace. And for that reason, we shamed it. And from doing shamatha practice, we need to do have meditation sessions. Then when we finish the session, then the thoughts occur. This naturally happens. And that 1 or 2 hours of shamatha that we finished is not so much does not bring much benefit afterwards. At the time, there's some benefit, but if we continue, but if we can, then it does not much bring much later. But if we are able to, whatever occurs, if you're able to sustain the nature and rest within that, then within that stillness there is motion. But there isn't. But we have said, we have when we have broken the bedroom, broken down the boundary between the two, then when there's motion, there can be motion within that. When that motion doesn't harm the subject. Stillness does not harm the motion does not harm the subject. The mind being still does not prevent the thoughts from occurring. When you can and the thoughts occurring does not the thoughts occurring does not harm the stillness. And so as Paltrow Rinpoche says, when you have to break down the boundary in between the stillness and the mind, and when you look at the nature of them, then there's stillness, and so the occurrence does not harm the stillness of the mind. So when you with the motion, look at the staying position. When you rest within that, that is the non-dual yoga, and so that is awareness, and that comes with the first we know the individual of stillness and motions. When we talk about this, then we cut down the boundary between stillness and motion, and then when you realize that there's no difference between that, when you're aware, and when you know that, that is what we call awareness. And that's what we talk about, the unaltered mind, the fresh mind. That's the mind letting it be. So there's a time when you use the difference. If we always say the basic mind, the natural state, that's what. When you're just sitting in a blank state, that's not the unabated. So we have to have we have to grasp our own place. We have to cut through the root, grasp our own place, and then and recognize the Dharma nature. Then whatever thoughts occur, they occur within the Dharma experience. And when they subside, then we realize that they are like dreams and illusions, and are that do not exist of their own, then we can rest in the fresh, unaltered nature of mind. That's what this means. So as Milarepa said, the unaltered, whatever the thoughts happen to, whatever thoughts occur, and we recognize them without altering them, if you grasp your own place, then they're naturally liberated. So as it says, just as the clouds have mist dissipated in the expanse of the sky, not going anywhere, not staying anywhere, so does the thoughts of the mind arising from mind. Seeing your mind purifies the thoughts with mind. It's like purifies means that you don't lose them. They just dissolve into the nature of the mind. And so whether they're eating or whether they're talking to people or whether all the things need to be just... need to be embraced by this, and so when it is, then there's no harm in it. And it's said that it's very pleasant for the yogi who reaches this state. The difficulties becomes because of the bonds of the thoughts, and so we'll leave it there for today. Now we do a bit of meditation for five meditation. Just talking all the time doesn't help. We have to do some meditation. Now, what you're meditating is what it. It's just as thoughts cease and unexcelled enlightenment cease. As first, we think about it. Another thing, what happened is you can make thoughts arise. You can think about a virtuous thought arise. You can make a thought of revulsion if you can think of it. You can think about where it came from, what its essence and characteristics, how does it go, examine how it is. Then, like a thought of impermanence, if you make a particular thought arise, and then look at its where it comes from, where it stays, where it perishes, or otherwise, If you're someone who has some experience in meditation, you could rest in the look directly at the ordinary nature of myself. And looking directly, I see the nature of mind. By letting alone, I see the nature of it. I realize the nature of it. By relaxing, I grasp my own place. Relaxing and resting, I grasp my own place. So grasping your own place is really important, as I said before. The result of meditation is grasping your own place. So you have looking directly, letting it alone. These are the first look directly. Then after that, you just let it alone. And then you just relax and rest. And by relaxing and relaxing, you observe distinguish the good and bad in the river of thought. And then give it a completely cut through thoughts. So entirely cut through all moving. So no thinking about this, please rest in meditation for a while. Now, at this point, when a thought occurs, do not view the thought as a fault. Recognizing the nature of the thought, in that very instant, the thought is self-liberated. It is self-liberated. There's not applying an antidote. There's no thought of applying an antidote when the thought comes. The moment that the thought arises, you recognize the nature and see the nature. The thought is self-liberated, or liberated where it is. Like a wave subsiding into an ocean or an ice cube melting into water. This is self-arising, self-liberation. If you know this, then within the self-arising, self-liberation, the primordial nature, what we call Samantabhadra in the Dzogchen, and or core emergent in the Mahamudra, it is there from the beginning. It's not thought stop, and then only then that the wisdom comes from somewhere else. It's not like that. It's not something that comes new. It nakedly arises inside. That nature is with that wisdom is present with us, but is bound up by thoughts. It's there, but we don't recognize it. When we recognize the nature of the thoughts, that wisdom has been present within our continuum from the very beginning. And when the movement of thought is naturally purified, then it becomes revealed. It doesn't become when it is obscured by the faults and thoughts and so forth, then it doesn't grow strong. When you get to the point to this question of whether it is obscured or not, then when it is unobscured, then it is clearly seen. You see that the wisdom that is present within itself, the nature, the basic nature, and within recognizing that internal nature, we recognize ourselves.